I'm in a movie coming up. I hope I'm still in it. called Kong Skull Island. I think they're legally unable to say King Kong. I think that a different movie studio owns that name. And so I think we can't call it that.
But you can call anything Kong all day long.
Sure.
Fast and Furious, Kong.
Kong.
Just add a giant gorilla.
Rubber chew toy, Kong.
Hold on a second. You can have a giant gorilla movie where the giant gorilla is named Kong.
Yeah.
As long as you don't say King Kong.
I'm not a lawyer. I believe that's the case, yeah.
I hope everyone will enjoy my movie, Mr. Dracula.
Kong Skull Island. Kong Skull Island. Kong Skull Island, have you heard? Just saw a giant prehistoric bird. Saw a great big monkey swinging on vines. Saw Marc Evan Jackson milking his lines.
So, we were not expecting to record a vlog for this movie.
We were not expecting to record one, but I...
Which is why we didn't even see it until 3 weeks into its release.
Exactly. But we saw it today. It's Wednesday the something. And
The 29th?
The 29th.
I would check the date, but I'm using my phone
Wednesday
to record
this. It's
Wednesday
the 29th.
All right.
Wednesday the 29th.
Yeah, we weren't expecting to vlog this, but we were in the movie, and at the end I thought long and hard and said, yep, the video I planned for this week will not be done in time. So... We just saw Kong Skull Island. My name is David Doggins Gansel.
I am Some Jerk with a Camera, a.k.a. Tony Goldmark, a.k.a. Some Jerk with a Camera.
And I am Morgan, a.k.a. The Wire, a.k.a. Lady Barely Appearing on this internet.
And we got some dogs underfoot.
We have giant monsters roaming the background of the vlog.
Giant monsters roaming. It's very fitting.
And,
I said, God damn, that was a good one.
Awesome.
Holy God, that was fun.
If I could explain it without spoiling anything, I'd just say it has all the gruesome B-movie carnage and all of the disregard for human life that Jurassic World was going for, but with a lot less of the bullshit.
A lot less bullshit. This movie is unapologetically... a down and dirty 70s style grindhouse B movie.
Yeah, mm-hmm. It is a creature feature with numerous different creatures who compete with each other to get the most gristly ends.
And holy shit, there were some great looking creatures.
Yeah.
There were
some amazing,
really cool designs.
Kong looks amazing. All the creatures look great. I love the you got the little lizard monsters that look kind of like Eyes Wide Shut masks.
Yes, exactly.
It's just holy God, and this is the movie that I was hoping the Peter Jackson Kong would be, mm-hmm. and it's the movie the 70s Jeff Bridges Kong should have been, because this feels tonally, this absolutely could have been made in the 70s, and it feels like it was.
This is the movie I wish the animated musical The Mighty Kong had been.
Sure. I'm going to throw down a gauntlet. Best Kong movie since the original, since the 33 classic, because, I mean, I wanted to like the Peter Jackson Kong so much, but it was just so, for lack of a better word, pretentious.
Well, you know, I imagine that this is the kind of Kong movie Peter Jackson would have made if he had gotten greenlit for Kong before he made Lord of the Rings.
But yeah, back in his Frighteners, Alive era.
Yeah,
this
I can see that.
Like...
But it has a certain degree of irreverence to it, and it's part of its most endearing charm is it knows there is no possible way to overplay giant monsters killing humans and each other, and it just goes for it. It's like, let's just have...
This movie is a trip.
Let's have another montage to a pop song, because why not?
Crank up the great soundtrack, man. Great soundtrack. Now that said, like, the vast majority of the humans in the movie are just cannon fodder,
absolutely.
Of course they are.
Yeah.
The movie's not devoid of humanity. Like, I was actually touched by John C. Reilly's whole story.
I mean, it's
bare bones. It's traditional beats.
I thought they did a good job establishing, obviously these aren't terribly deep characters, but I thought that several of them were very well-established characters who you did get invested in eventually.
All the characters who were established were well-established. They were all pretty one-note, but they were clear, instantly relatable notes. Then there's a whole bunch of extras who just die.
Yeah. And you're not even sure exactly how many of them there are, just so they can keep killing them.
That was my one critique of the clarity of the film, was I was losing track of, like, who was dying, and early on when everybody gets separated and they're all sort of gradually meeting up with each other, there's lots of groups that you don't actually see meet up with each other, so it's just like, oh, so they found each other, okay, I can buy that, but some people meet each other, and I was like, oh, I assumed that guy had already gotten killed. And we'll get to that in the spoilers.
Yeah, there might have been some deleted scenes. Honestly, my biggest critique was that I thought the second act dragged a little.
You could see, like, I remember noticing during a montage where the characters were just walking, that at one point Brie Larson's character, who was wearing that sort of Ellie Sattler flannel shirt, there was a scene where they were walking through the swamp where she was suddenly in the tank top. And that became clear later on, like, oh yeah, eventually she takes off the shirt. But I mean, they must have moved that shot, or maybe that entire scene where they're going through the swamp.
Speaking of Brie Larson, I like that they subtly hinted that there might be a romance thing with her and Tom Hiddleston, but they never overtly say it.
Yeah.
There's no kissing scene or anything.
Right.
You know?
They're not a couple at the end.
Right.
I would buy that they had enough of a connection.
I buy that they could become one.
Right,
but
right.
It was honestly as friends.
Like,
it was honestly about the same level as Jin and the captain in Rogue One. There was a friendship forged in the bonds of hell there, and a chemistry there, but not a...
Well, I thought the second act dragged a little, and, you do get invested in the characters, but I thought the movie tried a little too hard to get us invested in the characters after all this crazy B-movie shenanigans that I fucking loved in the first act, that it almost felt like, to bring it back to a human level... almost felt wrong. Like there's always that moment in the second act of comedies, for example, where after just joke, they try to go for a heart moment, and it doesn't quite feel right. I'm not saying it's a deal breaker or anything. I'm just saying this is a 3.5-star movie with a fucking 4 or maybe even 5-star first act.
Mm.
Like, the first act was... The first act and the final climactic showdown were both really, really great, and the second act just dragged a little, but still.
Well,
fun.
I think part of the second act was they had a lot of balls in the air, just because literally scattered their characters all over the island, and these characters had different motivations and different resources available to them, and they all somehow needed to wind up at the place where the plot needs them to go.
Right.
And that was, that's not that easy to do when you're dealing with a large cast like this.
It's definitely an improvement over the 2014 Godzilla, which I liked, but... Well, A, there's more Kong in this movie than there is in Godzilla.
Yeah.
In
Godzilla.
No,
you,
oh, yeah,
you,
Kong.
They don't make you wait for Kong
right.
in this movie.
I honestly didn't expect Kong to be the first thing they encountered on the island. Like I expected, oh, they'll see some other shit first and it'll build to Kong, but nope.
No,
right off the bat.
They throw down the gauntlet.
Well, I was comparing that in my mind to the Gareth Edwards Godzilla movie and how you see several monsters before you see Godzilla.
Yeah.
Right.
So, on one hand, that's a good thing, because when Godzilla shows up, it's like, oh, shit. But with this one, I think they wanted you to relate to Kong a bit more, and so as a result they chose to establish him early as if he were a character as opposed to a creature.
Although the first thing he does is terrorize everybody.
First thing
he does is kill
everyone.
Aside from the cold open.
Right, but
he's going to be doing that anyway.
Oh, that's right, the
and,
cold open, yeah.
Yeah. He's going to be terrorizing them anyway, and the sooner you get that out of the way, the sooner that they can start to develop the relationship with Kong past that point. And it's a heck of a thing to get past.
Being attacked by a giant monster.
That they did it is just... This movie took all of these really stupid ideas and used them in such a smart way that everything worked.
That's kind of what it was. It took... There weren't really wasted elements at play. Aside from the fact that it dragged a little, like it used all the B movie cliches you want from something like this, but made sure to use them effectively, which is something Jurassic World didn't quite figure out.
It's not something that Peter Jackson's King Kong ever really figured out either, because Peter Jackson empathized with Kong a little bit too much.
What, you're saying you found that 2.5 hour, 3 hour King Kong movie that was just 2 hours of constant peril that was so repetitious you fell asleep multiple times to be a slog? It's like, I know. Yeah,
It's just, you see that, and then you see, because I was thinking of the Peter Jackson King Kong movie, and I was thinking of the Gareth Edwards Godzilla movie, mm-hmm. and then I'm looking at this movie, and here's the thing, this movie makes it look easy,
mm-hmm.
Because it goes for it, and everything it goes for it gets, and it makes it look effortless, and you just know that if they had gotten it a little bit differently, they would have thrown the whole soup out of whack, and it wouldn't have worked.
It just has so much goddamn fun with the premise.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
You know, that's why I was saying, you know, Grindhouse, because it felt like Peter Jackson especially felt like he was being just so... He was trying so hard to be reverent to the source material.
He was really, like... I know Peter Jackson is such a huge fan of the original movie.
Yeah.
And he wanted to remake it to honor it.
And this one was more just, let's just throw a bunch of crazy shit at the screen.
Let's make it crazy. Giant monsters killing each other. What more do we need?
Because again, so it's interesting because while we're on the subject of remakes, the other movie the three of us saw in the past month was the Beauty and the Beast remake.
Yeah. Which you can see the one movie. I'm sure that'll be in the
description. Yeah, click the...
Because YouTube doesn't have annotations anymore.
That's bullshit.
Yeah, if you're watching this and you have to choose between the Beauty or the Beast,
go with the reboot of
Let
Twas
the Beast
Beauty.
Kill the Beauty.
Yeah, go with the reboot of Twas Beauty Killed the Beast and not the reboot of Beauty and the Beast.
Right.
Here's the thing. Yeah, I had so much more fun in this one, even though, like, so I...
Well, this isn't even a remake, really.
No, it's really. It just uses the...
The character, who can't even legally be called King Kong. He can't be called Kong.
Yeah, that's why they keep saying, like, oh, he's
Kong. He's Kong. He's King. He's King. It's
Kong,
okay.
The King.
Way to get around that.
And the thing is, like, you compare, like... I'm not particularly a giant monster movie fan. I mean, I enjoy them, but, like, it's not a genre I'm passionate about. Compared to, you know, the 91 Beauty and the Beast is a movie, you know, it's my favorite Disney animated movie,
right.
And it is a movie I'm passionate about. And maybe it's because of that I was just so much more invested in this movie that could actually surprise me and grab me and not just remind me of a thing I'd rather be watching.
Yeah, I knew very little about this movie besides what I'd seen in the trailer. And as a result, like, particularly when I saw how they were offing people and the fact that they play character deaths as if they're jokes. It's just...
That said, the two movies do have something in common, and that's a guy who really wishes the war wasn't over.
Yeah! And by the way, the Vietnam stuff in this... brilliant, I think.
Oh,
it's very well done.
It's kind of a perfect, like...
Yeah, it was like... They weave in some metaphors that some of them subtle, some of them not so subtle,
right.
but
some of them very overt.
It's very thematically relevant that they're not just choosing Vietnam for the sake of, well, let's make it the 70s for no reason. Like,
no, there's a very specific reason why they're, you know, that, because Samuel L. Jackson's character, if we can get into spoiler territory.
Let's get into spoiler territory.
Yeah.
You've already seen the movie. It's been out for 3 weeks.
Exactly.
Spoilers!
And if you haven't, go. Yeah, uh-huh. Just go. Just,
go
yes,
see it.
Go see it.
Whatever your
Jackson is just, it's like he eventually becomes the villain over the course of the movie, or at least the de facto mm-hmm. villain, but you still absolutely understand his motivations. Mm-hmm. You know, he's not just, you know, the cowling evil. Like, you get it. He feels, you know, regret over losing Vietnam.
I hate every ape I see, from chimpanzee to chimpanzee.
He basically becomes Captain Ahab, sort of.
Yeah,
but
he does become Captain Ahab.
But
they named one of their characters Conrad. As in Joseph Conrad, as in Heart of Darkness.
Good catch.
I was going to say, he was a little bit of Colonel Kurtz, even though he wasn't the character who was, you know, isolated in the jungle.
This was kind of Apocalypse Now with giant monsters.
And he almost got in a motherfucker at the end.
He almost got in a
motherfucker.
He did get in a hold on to your butts.
Yeah, they referenced. Yeah, it's like,
they did it.
I see what you do. But although I did notice that it was probably ADR'd in post, so it might have been just,
And we did get Nick Fury facing off against Loki.
Yeah, at long last. But with
the roles reversed.
With the roles reversed, yeah.
You had a comment during one scene when Sam Jackson was facing down Kong.
I've had it with this snake fighting monkey on this. I don't know the rest. You
on this Monday to Friday island.
I don't know. No, that doesn't scan.
This is the back of a dog's head in front of my face.
My dog really wants to be in pictures.
Yeah, but your dog is facing the wrong way.
She's like, this is my best side.
All right.
Now,
Daisy, come on. Daisy. Leave the nice Doggins alone. Come on.
Dog meet Doggins.
Hey.
So that's the dog. You're the Gans, I guess.
Yep. And the two of us together make a perfect team. Now, me being the comedy nerd, there was another Jackson I was interested in seeing in this movie.
He is Sports Nevada Marshall on Mars.
I'm from Earth.
What is it with Jacksons and Kong?
Who knew? Jacksons, Kongs, they're trapped together
Peter
forever.
Peter Jackson, Sam Jackson, and now...
And now Mark Evan Jackson.
Yes.
The first thing...
I was very surprised that he lived as long as
I was shocked. See, here's the thing. When this cast was first announced, and I found out that Mark Evan Jackson would be in this movie, I was excited to see it because I'm a big fan of his. I've met him a couple times. He's a great guy, and he's, you know, he's great on Brooklyn Nine-Nine, Parks and Rec. He was great in 22 Jump Street, and of course he's great on The Thrilling Adventure Hour.
On the plains of the Red Planet, I uphold the law, and I do it with a pair of robot fists.
As soon as I heard he was in it, I figured, well, surely he dies in the first 15 minutes, because one, he's barely in any of the promotional material, and two, he always gets cast as the deadpan, stuffy bureaucrat, and that's the type of character who always dies in these movies. And yet, he outlived John Goodman.
Every other single Landsat guy gets killed, mm-hmm. except for you. So then I start to think, he's going to make it. He's going to be the last of the Blue Jackets.
Yep.
But alas, no. So I want to start this interview with talking about your death line, or more appropriately, your acceptance of death line.
Mm-hmm.
You just say, oh, dear.
I do. I was giddy, though, when I got the draft of the script showing this one, because oh, dear is something I say in life.
That's what I do, too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm scrolling through to see how long I last and if it's a cool death. And the words on the page are, oh, dear. And I was like, oh, man, that was 100% written for me. And I can't wait to execute it.
Well, he only had like six lines.
Oh, yeah. He's an extra for most of it, basically.
Yeah,
he's a featured extra in most of his scenes.
He was the bureaucrat who was hanging out with Samuel L. Jackson's group.
Right. And at the end, he's like, well, I don't want to be on the porch. and he's...
Like, you know what? Maybe you should be on the porch because you've been on borrowed time the entire... Speaking of people who I have no idea why they were there, who was that Asian girl? Who was like?
I think they just thought they needed another.
She was
diversity.
Sort of expert.
Yeah, they introduced her as a biologist, but she's looking at the geological equipment, and never does anything at all biologisty.
I feel like there were so many characters in this film, and they felt the need, maybe in the script form, to give all of them backstories and give all of them scenes in their own, right. And then in post they're like, this movie's running too long.
Except for the ones... So some of them just die, and others... Tell us a little bit about themselves.
The movie, the movie does pass the Mako Mori test, but not through her. But through Brie Larson's character. So. fucking white women.
I actually liked the payoff for Brie Larson's character. I liked the role that she got to play in the very end of the movie.
Well, there were
they set that up well.
That was really good, and there's homages to basically her being the Fey Wray character.
Exactly.
But
exactly.
She's not over, you know, she's not a damsel in distress.
Yeah,
she's very
not.
Capable on her own. And
there's hints of that in the fact that she, you know, rides in Kong's hand at the end.
Yeah, but...
Well, yeah, but that's the only time it happens. And before then, she hasn't really been directly rescued from anything.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Maybe that skull thing that one time.
John C. Reilly's character was so damn great.
He was great.
He
was great. He was the best part of the movie, I thought. Well, it was really his story.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
we started with him, and he was...
Well, but it wasn't played... They didn't...
They started with young him.
Yeah.
Well,
played by
some other... They didn't do the thing that Walk Hard specifically parodied, where it's
yeah.
like, my 14-year-old boy!
Speaking of which, so I'm assuming this is still only your second favorite movie with John C. Reilly and Richard Jenkins.
Yes, that's
after Step Brothers.
Richard Jenkins has a cameo early on, and
yes.
he's always great.
He has a scene with John Goodman, so it's almost like you're watching the Coen Brothers' King Kong.
Oh, yeah! It's the kind of movie where fucking Loki is fighting lizard monsters with a samurai sword.
That was the moment, like, he grabs John C. Reilly's sword and grabs a gas mask.
Well, just the moment in the prologue where the young John C. Reilly and a Japanese soldier both shoot each other down over this island in World War II, and they both land on the beach, they're both alive, and they fight each other, and then... They're fighting each other, and the Japanese guy pulls out a samurai sword,
which they gave to their specifically the would-be kamikaze pilots.
Right. And then fucking Kong shows up, and it's like, I'm in heaven. This is what more do you need? Fucking Kong and samurai sword.
Well, realizing at the end that they were setting up that Kong was kind of breaking up fights.
Right,
throughout.
Yeah.
That's kind of a thing that he does.
That's a good point, yeah.
Yeah, you don't really...
The dog's blocking you again.
Because, like, you see that scene at the beginning, and you just figure, well, they're both dead, and you find out later, oh, that's not how they die.
No.
And then they become allies fighting off the big monsters.
Yeah. We don't see any of that. We just hear it.
Right.
But yeah, and that was more of the, you know, John C. Reilly in his time on Skull Island kind of goes from soldier to peacenik.
Daisy,
you can dub
down.
In yourself saying literally anything.
What did you guys think of the gratuitous slow motion and many, many musical montages?
The musical montages I was okay with. The slow motion worked better in some moments than in others.
Yeah, that felt a little gratuitous when it felt a little unneeded when just the action as is would have been great. There was one really great jump scare about midway through the movie.
Oh yes, when
literally made me scream loudly. In the theater. And
also, there were a surprising number of children in our theater.
Yeah, that's just that. Needing something desperate to do on a Thursday afternoon. It's like, oh, it's a monkey, you know, monkey movie.
Like, I'm sure...
We're talking little kids.
Yeah, like 3 or 4 years old. There were several times in the movie when we heard babies cry.
I'm not one to say, you know, what films will or won't be appropriate for individual children. That's for the parents to decide.
This film probably traumatized some of them.
Yeah, this film is... Not one that I would take kids to, but that's the point.
I might take a 10-year-old to it if it was like a really cool 10-year-old.
Yeah.
But any younger than that, I wouldn't.
But,
yeah, well, it would depend.
You know, 10-year-old on a skateboard with sunglasses.
Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah, it would depend on the kid.
The violence gets pretty gruesome.
Yeah.
Like a dude's arm gets ripped off. There's blood and helicopter blades. It's.
I actually felt really sorry for that guy because he had just like he had finally. They did a great job of timing their kills to the moments where. Okay, I know you say that the second act was slow, and I agree with that, but it's more long than it is slow.
Honestly.
They did a pretty good job when the movie wanted to bring it down and kind of lull you into a sense of security, or even just a sense of, like, okay, now we're gonna go do this thing, and they hit you out of nowhere.
It's got a lot of great suspense in it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of great moments where it does that thing that war movies do, that sometimes war movies overdo, but here it worked, where all the sound goes out, it's just like a deafening silence, and you're just waiting for something to happen, and then something does, so...
Or even just a shot of a character's back, and you see them freeze, and you just know that there's something just off screen, and you have to wait for it.
So, what were some of your favorite monster designs in the film? Because there were some kind of creative ones in there.
I have to say the one that made me go, the most, was just because I'm a huge arachnophobe, was the bamboo spider.
The giant bamboo-legged spider. That was pretty creepy.
If you got a spider, because I know Haley didn't want to see this movie in theaters because of the spider.
But it's just one scene, so
I think a couple people die as a result of it, but otherwise it doesn't really affect the plot.
This is the spoiler section, so they cannibal holocaust it.
Yeah.
Somebody
yeah.
gets it right through the gullet.
Yep.
Oh, man.
Couldn't have aimed it better.
There were some creatures for creature's sakes, like that, you know, walking log thing, and...
But that was a setup...
That was a setup for that jump scare, right? That was a fake out.
And I think that's why that particular creature was so non-aggressive, that the guy was even shooting it in the face, and the creature's like, just goes away.
Well, and then there was, like...
So you're like, oh, okay, this isn't going to be that bad.
The first time the giant yak thing showed up and starts coming at him.
My answer to your question is the giant yak thing. I love that.
And the first time the yak thing showed up and the guy's holding his gun at it, all I could say was, quick, shoot it before it sings Evermore.
Yeah. Now I know she'll never leave me.
The director of this, this is his first feature film. I know I checked out his IMDb a while back. I think before this, he's mostly just directed Funny or Die shorts, so...
It's what you do instead of things.
Pretty much, yeah.
That kind of explains why, you know, he put in people like Marc Evan Jackson and Eugene Cordero, and you know, there's, like, filling out a couple comedy people in the smaller filler.
But it definitely, did have that sense of just mindless, awesome fun to it. It was great. Highly recommended.
Yeah.
Great movie.
Just looking at the sheer number of production companies, you can tell this movie was somebody's passion project. Someone really was determined to get this thing made.
And by the way, speaking of Peter Jackson, one slight thing about the film was this is a film with maybe a couple too many endings. Like this, there's literally three different endings in this film. Four if you count the post credits tag. Which, by the way, there is a post credits tag. So
that's worth staying for.
You're gonna want to
see this.
And
even though it's mostly just confirmation of what you already suspected.
Yeah. But oh man, this.
Although
it's interesting that they literally had the other black guy, who was not Samuel L. Jackson, give the "there's a bigger world out there"
That's
speech.
True, that's
so,
true.
that might have been a deliberate nod.
I'm here to talk to you about the TOEI initiative.
And I love that this film, you know, That's how much of a B-movie it is. It knows that it's going to eventually spin off into Kong versus Godzilla and be that kind of movie specifically. And it's just going head first into it, which is a welcome kind of change.
And you can even say that they were establishing that earlier with the Japanese soldier and the bits of Japanese...
That's true.
Tonally, definitely, which is a welcome reprieve after... The Gareth Edwards Godzilla, which is fun, but doesn't have nearly as much of a sense of humor about itself as this one. I think I can remember one joke in the 2014 Godzilla, so...
Yeah, no, the 2014 Godzilla, I mean, I like it, but I like it because of the sense... It has the same problem, kind of, that the Peter Jackson movie had, where it's kind of too reverent of its source material. And so whenever Kong...
Edwards making a film too reverent of its...
I know.
The devil, you say?
This movie had some really great visuals. Like even aside from the monster designs, like, there were just... I mean, there's a lot of sunset shots. There's a lot of, places in the jungle where just, shots... just really looking eerie.
Like Apocalypse Now, like silhouettes against the sun type of...
There's silhouettes, there's a lot of ethereal lighting in various places of the jungle. It creates such a great sense of atmosphere that it makes me almost mad that the existing Skull Island attractions on both coasts are not based on this universe.
Yeah.
Because that's like... Fuck Pandora. This is the island I want to explore. These are the creatures absolutely. I want to get up close to.
Yeah, the IOA attraction is even called Skull Island, Reign of Kong. So,
I haven't ridden that yet. I haven't seen any footage of it yet. So maybe that's really cool. I don't know, but...
But it is kind of weird that they'd open a ride just before this movie came out, like literally less than a year.
I mean, maybe...
And they're both called, and they both have Skull Island in the title.
I mean, to be fair, it's not the first time that Islands of Adventure attendance has benefited from somebody else's cinematic universe.
That's true.
So...
Oh, yeah.
That's true.
They should just... Okay, now some other studio needs to make a Dudley Do-Right movie.
Exactly.
Or a Dudley Do-Right Popeye extended universe, and the whole west side of that place will be completely...
You know, Sony needs to get their hands on a Seuss cinematic universe.
Right. A cinematic Seussiverse.
The important thing is it can't be Universal making any of these movies.
No, that would ruin it.
Yeah. Well, I think that covers it. This was just an awesome, just visceral movie-going experience. You know, I'm sure I'm going to watch it again later and be like, well, these story elements don't hold up, but that's not what this movie's going for.
It's one of those movies where the story doesn't quite matter, and you forgive the plot holes just because it's so much goddamn fun.
Yeah.
And, yeah. Anything else? Or?
A lot more fun than Beauty and the Beast.
Yes.
Much more fun than just about anything with a giant monster in it that I can think of.
Yes.
Pacific Rim.
Pacific Rim. Okay. Okay, imagine if Pacific Rim were made in the 70s.
Yeah.
And
But with today's special effects technology.
Special effects. And so that's why it's a creature feature. 70s style creature feature with gratuitous death and crazy monster carnage and all this stuff. But because it's being made now the special effects are finally cheap enough that you can make this kind of movie level and have it be this gonzo. Like, you want to see this movie. You do.
Definitely.
You just do.
And you already have because it's been out for 3 weeks.
Because it's been out for weeks and... Yeah. We are late to the game, as always. I'm recording this on an iPhone that I just got yesterday. Until then, I've had a dumb phone, so, you know. You tell me about being late to the game.
Right. So, until next time, Kong Skull Island! Kong Skull Island!
And I reckon I'll be riding in the name of truth and justice for as long as I can count the shooting stars. For I've sworn by the birds of mine, past whispers, to right the outlaw wrongs.
Yes, he likes the upper world. So come on.